My guest today is Judy Wagner. And Judy was the primary care support, wonderful person, and most of the time person for her mom who have dementia.
Yeah, and I have to put a little caveat on that. I was not necessarily doing the hands-on with my mom because we were lucky enough to be able to afford help for have hands-on people help her for part of the time in her house. And then we eventually had to move her into a memory care unit. So, but I seemed to be the one coordinating everything, making sure everything got done. The one mom called when she was, when she had a problem, when she was upset. But I actually was not much of a hands-on caregiver.
Okay, so this is really both exciting, but also important to note. Judy, you understand that your job was to represent your mom, to be your mom's advocate, but also to be your mom's support and to be present for your mom when she needed you and to coordinate all the other people who were in her life. And so when I said she was the primary carer for mom, she was. But yeah, Judy gets that there is a difference between hands-on caring and being a care support person and being the care partner for someone. And you get it.
Yeah. Well, I physically could not be there. She needed a lot of care. She was a Lewy body dementia patient with Parkinsonian symptoms. So she needed a lot of care. She could not do anything for her. Exactly. She dropped a tissue. She could not pick it up. Yeah. Someone would have to pick it up for her. And so I was also working full time during a good part of mom's care, at a demanding job. It was 50, 60 hours a week that I was working. I had a husband and a son living with me. So I really needed to get a care group of providers in to take care of mom. And that was,
I mean, and the thing that Judy, how long did it take you to figure out that number one, you couldn't do this alone? And number two, she was going to need 24/7 with this Lewy body thing. How long did that take you? I'm just curious.
It wasn't actually that long at all. My family is very small. It was my mother, my father, my brother, and me. And we didn't have any real extended family. And then we were all concerned about my father. He had heart problems and he did pass away from heart disease. And so in 2014, so I know what it feels to grieve the loss of a parent. And then very shortly after my dad passed away, mom admitted to hallucinations. Oh. And when she admitted to hallucinations, we brought her to a neurologist who said, diagnosed her pretty much, a month after dad died. And then about 4 or 5 months later, my brother was with her and she fell down and broke her knee. And so that's really when it was very apparent that she would need 24/7 care.
Yeah. How anxious did your mom stay most of the time? Was she somebody who had pretty high anxiety or pretty high distress state, or was she really comfortable with life?
She was somewhere in the middle.
Okay.
She, as long as you kept her happy, she wasn't that anxious. If she had any concerns about somebody there to meet all her needs immediately, then she became very anxious. So the idea, and it took me a little time to catch on to this, was to keep mom happy. It was not to debate mom. It was not to have a rational argument that this is better for you, mom. It was just to keep mom on an even keel and keep her happy.
So you did a lot of, I'm going to call it tap dancing. I would call it putting on a performance And at the same time, looking like everything's fine and going, I don't know where we're going next.
Exactly.
I'm really worried about what's going to happen if she keeps doing this. Yeah, that'll be great. Okay, I hear you, Mom. I mean, and never really being able to relax at all because not knowing for sure what's going to happen in the next 15 minutes.
Yeah, in a way that's true. And in a way, I guess my own personality is not to get too, I think everything's always going to turn out right. I guess I'm the internal optimist. There's nothing, I have no idea. You know, Mom lived 5 years after diagnosed with Lewy, and I had no idea what I was in for during those 5 years. I didn't find you until maybe year four. So I was sort of feeling my way, exactly, trying to see what made sense. You know, I determined myself it made sense not to argue with her.
Because it wasn't getting you anywhere. Exactly. I mean, it wasn't helping her. It was just,
it was distressing her. Exactly.
Yeah, it was making it so much worse. It did not make a difference in a good way.
No. So we just, tried to, after that, keep her happy. The hardest part was getting good people.
That was going to be my next question.
Okay.
How many helpers did you go through before you found people who got your message of, we want, if she says there's a purple dog in the kitchen, ask her if it's hungry or if it's okay to, do we need a pillow for it or is it okay?
We went through quite a few. We didn't go through the bad ones quickly enough. We were hoping, the devil you know versus the devil you don't know type of thing. We went with an agency at first, and we got one really good one from the agency, but the other ones were not as good.
Would you say the word you're looking for is flexible? They were not willing to be flexible with your mom, or was it something different? What word would you say was the biggest challenge for them with your mom?
Maybe they weren't really trained in handling someone with Lewy body. I'm not sure. The agency I knew, they did the intake, but I think they have a hard time filling a lot of these positions, and it's a tough job. It's a demanding job, and they don't get paid.
But. Yeah. But then they waste all this time sending you people that aren't trained, and they apparently think a body is worth something, but it doesn't actually work out. You're still on the lookout because it's not working.
We gave up with the agency. I have to admit, after having a few people with the agency, we gave up with them, and I said, I can do better interviewing people and trying to find somebody who can work with Mom. And if they were working for me and I treated them right, then they would treat Mom right. It was always whoever worked for us was like our family. And if they needed time to take care of a child, they got time to take care of a child. I treat them well, they treat Mom well.
So you built a family for your mom. Literally built a family for your mom.
Yes, I did.
And I'm going to come back to that because I'm wondering whether there's an element of that in where you are. So you got your mom some decent caregivers, some good caregivers, and some caregivers that, that's not going to work out after all. I thought I picked somebody, but it's not.
We had all of them. We had the whole range from great to, please don't come back.
What was I drinking when I did that interview?
Exactly. Although drinking's another topic. I heard you said that once 4 out of 5 families will not pull together and will not work well. You're right, Tifa. I should get some credit for that.
And what about your own family? Did your own family keep going while you were doing this?
Yes. I have two wonderful children. They're out of the house and sort of off the payroll is what we always say. They're self-supporting.
That sounds good.
which is wonderful, because I'm being used to being an advocate. They were both born deaf. So I had been advocating for them since they were born. So I, you know, moved from taking care of my children to taking care of my mom sort of within a couple of years that, being an advocate is not an issue for me.
Wow, Judy. I mean, and so you've been on this journey to be this care support for your mom since who knows when. I mean, you literally have been learning things about yourself and about systems and about having to advocate and about making hard choices and not turning around and going back, but saying, okay, well, this is where we are now. So here are our two choices. Which one am I going to do? I mean, wow.
That's the way I think, you know, lay out the alternatives, give me the pros and cons of each, and then we'll make the best decision with the information we have and move on.
Wow. So as your mom's well-being deteriorated farther and further, just because Lewy body is like that, and it got to be trying to manage to get her carers in the house 24/7 in the situation just got to be unrealistic.
What really helped a lot is I had a cousin who is a nurse, and she had just quit her job. And I said, would you come? You want to live here? We'll pay you and you can have free warm and, you know, and she agreed to come, which was excellent. So yes, she saved the day for 2 years. She was in
Pause, Judy. Who saved the day for 2 years? Because you negotiated that contract?
I did.
Yeah, you sure did.
We all did.
But you built that family team. Wow.
But she lived in the house with my mother and brother for 2 years and really helped an awful lot. So, you know,
congratulations. Wow. So just when it was getting to the place of, we don't know if we can keep this going, you looked around, found this, figured this out,
yes,
and found her and brought her in and made her part of this mix for two more years.
My mother-in-law also had dementia, and she was living with the other mother-in-law, you know, on the other side of it. And I said, we need somebody from the family. If I could find someone to move in with them. And so it was just an idea. And I took a shot in the dark and she said, yes. It kept it going for two more years.
Yeah.
I don't know if we would have reached the crux of having to go into assisted living earlier had we not been able to get the family help. Yeah. But the family help kept it going for two more years.
I mean, I will say often when you cannot figure out what you're going to do with some of the toughest moments, the toughest times, to coordinate some stuff so you can breathe, because it's getting to where you can't even take a deep breath without another phone call, without another crisis, without another call out, without another this, without another that. That's not sustainable. So, wow, nice work.
Oh, yeah. No, we were so lucky. I mean, that kept it going for 2 years.
Can you hear that it wasn't just luck?
I know. It's not. It's a little bit of luck, a little bit of skill, a little bit of me reaching out to her and
determination. It was determination that you were your mom's representative and you were going to do the best you could, and you did. Wow.
She came in, and about the time she fortunately for her, not so fortunately for me, she got engaged and wanted to move out. I'll say this luck, but maybe it's not, but they were just completing an assisted living facility about a mile from our house.
How did you know that they were completing an assisted living?
Used to drive by it all the time and signs and And it was in the back. Well, I had already been to several places.
Oh, so you'd already been looking around.
Yes, I had already been looking around in case we needed a plan B or a plan C, or, you know, so I was getting plan B and whatever in order. And the fact that it was only a mile from the house and it was brand new, it's got good and bad points to it. But the fact that it was so close to the house, I could visit mom every day, which I wound up doing for the year she was there. But you know, she was probably about the third or fourth person that moved into that facility. And as a matter of fact, the facility, the memory care unit, was run by a woman who took your courses. She knew you. Should I give you her name? You could edit it out. Maureen Charlton.
Oh, my heavens, Maureen. Oh, Maureen and I go way back. Back for the Alzheimer's Association.
Yes, that's where she was. That's where she was when so she was running the memory care unit. And in fact, I didn't know you at the time, and I didn't know she had been working with you. It was one day when I was there talking to her, I said, you know, I was searching the internet and I ran across this lady, Tifa Snow. And I thought, you know, I said, she's great. She explains everything just in the way you, and she goes, I trained under Tifa. And then we did, what is it? Retain on the light, lose on the light.
Yeah. Good job, guys.
So she had a very good unit. The memory care unit was very good. And we were able to even supplement that with a private duty person during the daytime, because again, mom couldn't. She really needed one-on-one.
She wanted somebody in sight, in hands reach. I mean, that's when she would relax a little bit, when she knew she, and it really had a lot to do, which I know you get this, with her inability to do for herself.
Exactly.
She was so disabled with her mobility and her ability to hold on to things.
Yeah.
She really needed somebody to be present, to be, whew, I can breathe. She can only do it.
We moved the private care. The people from the house moved to Sunrise with her. So I took the best two that we had at the house.
Wow.
And they went to, and in fact, there's one woman that we're still friends with today. My husband and I went to her wedding. You know, she was so good. She really became part of the family. And so, you know, she went to Sunrise with mom. And whenever she was at Sunrise, she would advocate to the people in Sunrise, on which is sometimes better than the daughter advocate.
Absolutely, because they're there, and you could be backseat.
And she's a worker just like they are, you know. So they, you know, it's not the daughter again who wants everything for her mom. This is just somebody.
She's working with her mom who says she does better when I do this. Right. This is what she's looking for. If you'll do this, she'll tend to have less distress.
We were able to put, you know, talking with you through it and saying, my gosh, I did everything I could think I could do for mom. And we were able to,
to
help her a lot. But, you know,
so you used your resources as wisely as you could figure out how to use them to make sure your mom was getting that sense of relationship and of caring that she so needed to be okay.
The part I still, you know, have is that you said I didn't give myself enough credit, is that I couldn't be all that for my mom, you know, and mom, I guess, needed so much that nobody could be all that.
Nobody could be all that. And because it was essentially any waking moment.
Yes.
She needed a human being.
Exactly.
And to be there for her.
Yes. She want, and in the middle of the night, she also, she.
Absolutely.
She had to go to the bathroom several times every night and had no problem waking up the whole house.
Nope.
To go, she, you know, again, this is probably the Lewy talking, not her, but, you know, if she was up, she didn't, you know, everyone should be up.
Everybody should be up. It's time to get up right now.
Yeah. It's 2 a.m. and you had to go to work the next day.
Yeah. So you did all this for as long as she was alive.
Well, until we put her in the, you know, she was in the house for 4 years and she right. was assisted living for 1 year. And the trigger point in assisted living was my cousin leaving, plus the fact that she right. then became a two-person transfer.
Yeah. The mobility got so yes. bad that she was not safe with equipment, just with one person, and one yes. person could not assist her.
So I could not staff two people in her house.
You cannot. You could not.
It was just.
So why did you say that, well, when she went into assisted living, you didn't do a remarkable job?
She didn't. She was used to one-on-one care, and no matter how good an assisted living place mm-hmm. is, it is
and
not
you,
one.
And
on
you
one
still care. Had somebody there as much as was humanly possible.
We had someone there 8 hours a day, 7 days a week. You know, it just, someone.
Wow, Judy.
There at night. For her, you know, whenever she had to go to the bathroom. But, you know, at some point you just say, well,
you can't do 24/7. I mean, it's just, you're paying for two 24/7s and you couldn't do it in the house. Why do you think you could do it there? You can't.
Yeah, but mom didn't quite understand.
Mom didn't get that.
No, she didn't get that. But, you know, luckily dad left enough to take care of her, but I didn't want her to run out of money.
That's the other tricky part.
Yeah, you don't know how long it's going to go on.
You do not know with Lewy Body.
Exactly.
I have seen with Lewy Body, people last a really long time.
Right.
When you think there is no way they will be awake and alive come 2 days. 2 days, they'll be gone. Nope, they're back.
I didn't have an end date. So I was planning, you know, 10, 15 years out. And I'm saying, well, no, we just can't spend money at that rate.
Right.
You know, we have to make sure that it lasts as long as mom lasts. So, you know.
So she got satisfaction at least a goodly part of the day.
Yeah. And I was hoping she. And the people there, again, it was a good place.
Mom, it was. And people were responsive and people did listen to her. It just wasn't like.
It wasn't instantaneous.
Right there. Yeah.
You know, and it was a good place. So that right at the very beginning, they were took a little longer because they were getting their routines down.
They thought she was a quote unquote, I'm going to use this word. She was just a normal person with dementia. They did not realize the Lewy Body with the Parkinsonian and the distress over the move and the distress of losing her husband and all those things from her past were always cooking under the surface for her.
And I think also too, one of the reasons maybe I don't give myself as much credit as mom was not the nicest of people towards the end. You know, she would say to me, I wish I had six children so that they could take better care of me. You know, it's like you and your brother are useless, that sort of thing. So there you are.
Ouch. She knew how to absolutely stab right where the heart is.
Mom was a smart lady.
So you, of course, loved her so much. You would never say, Mom, I wish you had had six too so we could share the load. It would be so much easier.
Yeah, that would have been the best reply.
Yeah, it's like that would have been so much better, Mom. Why didn't you do that?
I just took it inside and internalized it that I'm not doing enough for mom.
Wow. Yeah. No, I mean, and really it was, Mom, you only had two kids and I'm the only one carrying a load right now.
Exactly. Yeah.
Wow. Would have been better if you had six, maybe. I don't know. I mean, we could try it. You want to go back and run it over again? I mean, she knew how to hurt, which is the tricky part of Lewy.
Yeah.
Other dementias, she wouldn't be able to do that. And at this point in Lewy, I mean, with all that involvement, she was still knew how to stick a pin.
Hey folks, thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe to help us spread TEEPS's positive approach message around the world. And don't forget to click the bell to get notified when new videos are posted.